Shalom and welcome to this edition of Revealing the Truth, where we cover the headlines, the heart lines, and biblical truth. I'm your host, the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, and we're joined today with Jack C. DeSelms, author of the newly released book, Great Christian Lie, The Truth on Passion Week. Jack DeSelms, welcome to the program.
Thank you, sir.
Jack, you were born in 1943 as a carpenter's son. When you were age 14, your mother passed away. Afterward, you went to a Seventh-day Adventist boarding school, served 20 years in the United States Navy, and you attend First Baptist Church in Western Missouri. What led you to a Seventh-day Adventist boarding school?
Well, when my mother passed away, my father and I, I've now determined, were too much identical. And so I wound up living with my sister. And my sister was a very devout Seventh-day Adventist. Well, she still is.
Okay.
And she had four children of her own, so I wound up going to the boarding school.
Okay. For those in our audience that don't know about Seventh-day Adventists, what can you share with us about the theology or doctrine of a Seventh-day Adventist?
Seventh-day Adventists at that time practiced the Leviticus eating rules, no pork, things of this nature.
Well, expand on that for me, please. Are we talking about the biblical commands or the rabbinical commands?
Biblical.
Okay, so we're talking about no pork, no shellfish. We're talking
cloven foot.
Cloven hoof, no carrion, nothing that eats other animals or dead flesh.
That's right. Other than that, the theology, my recollection, I remember this has been, you know, almost 50 years ago, my recollection of it, traditional evangelical type religion.
Okay, but they were also called Seventh-day Adventists for a reason.
Well, they observed Saturday as the Sabbath day.
Okay, did they observe Friday evening to Saturday evening, or did they just observe the day of Saturday?
Sundown to sundown.
Okay, sundown to sundown, which was the biblical definition of a day, Jewish Sabbath, as observed today, sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday.
Yes, sir.
Was there anything else about Judaism or the foundation of the Old Testament that they embraced?
Well, there's a very close affinity between the Seventh-day Adventists and Judaism. You know, the church recognized at that time that there was, Judaism was the foundational religion pretty much of what they were doing.
Okay.
So it was I'm very comfortable working in both worlds.
I understand. And what translation or version of the Bible did they use?
Predominantly King James.
King James. Okay, so were they part of the crowd that said if it was good enough for Paul, it's good enough for me?
I don't recall that conversation.
Yeah,
that sounds logical.
Yeah, that would be a joke because Paul wasn't around at the writing of the King James.
Right.
King James wasn't around when Paul was around. So it's a common phrase that makes me laugh every time I hear it because it's so out of context from the dates and times of the writing of the King James that it's comical to me.
A little history goes a long way.
It does. They say that there's nothing like a little history, and that's nothing like a little history. So you served 20 years in the Navy. What did you do after that?
Well, after I retired from the Navy, got into computer programming. And I was a mainframe computer programmer for 30 years, predominantly working in the payroll arena, things of that, payroll accounting and the bookkeeping side.
Okay. I have a lot of experience in that area. I was with AT&T, then I had a staffing firm that provided mainframe computer programmers all over the world for IBM.
I was MVS, Cobalt 2, DB2.
I remember it well. Jack, you're in a Baptist church now. What drew you out of the Seventh-day Adventist? Was that just something you were sent to because of your sister, or was that something that you adopted for yourself?
Pretty much I was sent to it. My parents had no religion in their life. And so when my sister took me, she saw to it that I got into a religious environment.
Okay.
And that groomed me pretty well. I spent my 20 years in the Navy. Proverbs says, raise a man in the way of the Lord. When he becomes an adult, he'll return to the way. And that's pretty much what happened to me. When I graduated from high school and left the Adventist school, I pretty much left the Adventist church at that time. And then wasn't until 15, 20 years ago that I started attending the Baptist church, local Baptist church.
Okay, were you married, children?
I was married at that time, yes, and I have two children by her.
Okay.
I'm married. She's passed away, and I've remarried since then.
Okay.
Ruth Ann is my wife now.
Wonderful. And you live in Missouri. Now, you're close to a major city?
Kansas City.
Kansas City.
So. We're just on the outside of Kansas City. And the town is Weston.
Okay.
Weston is a tourist destination predominantly.
Okay. We have great friends in Kansas City. Shmuel Welkenfeld is the Messianic rabbi there in Kansas City. And Tas Seda is a former PLO sniper who lives in Kansas City with a ministry called Seeds of Hope and Hope for Ishmael.
Okay.
A former Muslim terrorist who accepted Jesus as his Messiah. Lives right there in the Kansas City area. So good people to get to know. In your upbringing and training, you were in a Seventh-day Adventist school, so I'm sure you had Bible classes that were required, Bible study that was required.
Oh, definitely.
And was it predominantly Old Testament, predominantly New Testament, or was it a pretty balanced teaching?
My recollection, again, we're talking 50 years ago, my recollection is that it was pretty balanced. You know, we went both into the Old Testament and New Testament, both.
Okay. Help me understand why Seventh-day Adventists, it's not really something that caught on as a quasi demonstration or reflection of what the first century church might have been. Have you looked at that? Have you studied that at all? You didn't stay with the Seventh-day Adventist. You went to a Baptist church. Did you attend church in the Navy?
I attended church infrequently while I was in the Navy.
Okay. So,
The time I spent in the Navy, I would classify myself as non-religious.
Okay. So the teaching you got was not something that stuck with you or shaped you or molded you from a faith journey perspective.
Well, what I've come to understand is I have a very large section of my personality that's a helper or a servant.
Okay.
Which would come out of that, you know, that's fundamental teaching of the Adventists.
Okay, kind of based on the statement that Jesus said, "I didn't come to serve, to be served. I came to serve."
That's correct. And while I was attending the Adventist church, they were still practicing the foot washing.
Okay,
that's been dropped, as I understand it. My sisters told me they've dropped that procedure.
You know what's so interesting about the foot washing ceremony, and I might take you through a little bit of Jewish thought, a little bit of Hebrew thought from a New Testament perspective, is that, of course, there was no New Testament at the time of Jesus.
Right.
That the blessing has been in Hebrew for quite some time. May you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. This was a concept that the dust of your rabbi was his teaching. It was
okay.
Not the dust of the ground. It was that as you're walking the roads, and at the time of Jesus we're talking about the Roman roads, which were cobbled, which were stone, which were dusty and dirty. You had Hamsim, which are the winds coming out of Egypt, which are sandy, gritty,
yep.
Laying the foundation of dust. And so as you're walking along and your feet are kicking up dust, your words ride on the dust. And as these teachings fall upon you, so does the dust of the earth and the words that come upon you. So okay. Jesus then comes to the point at the Last Supper, the Passover Seder, the representation, and he's very clear to say how long I've wanted to celebrate this Seder with you. He doesn't say yes. The Seder, he says this, which is very clear in the Hebrew, not so clear in the Greek. And so he goes to wash their feet. They protest.
Definitely they do.
And he says to them, and you have to carefully listen to the words. He said, if you do not let me do this, you have no part in me. The word in is very, very important. In Hebrew, it's an idiomatic language. The words are very, very significant. They mean a very significant thing. The word in is much different than the word on. Completely
sure.
Different. Okay. On is superficial. In is within that concept. So what is he saying?
Indwelling.
Right. So what is he saying to them? He's saying to them, you're concerned about me washing my teaching from you. I'm telling you and I'm encouraging you to know my teaching is not on you. My teaching is in you. This is the perfect picture of what we understand the parables. I was taught parables as a child by my rabbi, who I sat with for many years. This is a way of teaching that is illustrative. It is part of the scripture, as we know that this was a method that was used to use illustrative language, which is what Hebrew is. It's an illustrative language. It's a word picture language. It paints such an incredible picture. Did you have any of the Hebrew studies when you were in school, or have you done any since you've left school?
No and no.
Okay.
Is that my only experience with the Hebrew is what I picked up in the process of working on my book, which was not that much.
Okay. In your upbringing, in your life, and in your recent life as you came back to your faith walk, what was it that when you went to the Baptist church, what was it that you heard that caused you to want to stick with it?
Oh, the story of the redemption of Jesus. You know, what he went through because he wanted me to be saved. You know, that got to me real hard.
You had a Navy career. Did you see battle during that career?
I jokingly say, yes, I've had large round projectiles coming in my direction at a high velocity.
Okay. So
fortunately, I was never impacted by any of them.
Well, we're glad to hear that.
You know, I spent better part of, I was in and out of Vietnam for all 10 years of the war. I did military intelligence while I was there.
Okay.
So.
That experience, as you look at PTSD, you look at things that other people have gone through, what did you find was something that sustained you through that time?
Remembering, well, the work that I did, if I was successful in my work, people would live. If I failed in my work, people would die. You know, it was that type of a job.
Okay.
And just the total commitment that I want that daddy to go home to his children. You know, that was that type of focus. People's lives depended on me, and I knew it, and I did everything in my power to take care of them.
Okay, that's very mission-focused, very committed. Scripture says, no greater gift than this than for one man to lay down his life for another. And so this is something that, you know, you talk about, you don't remember the schooling, you don't remember the lessons, but yet the foundational truth seemed to have stuck with you in the application of biblical concepts, biblical truths.
That's a correct statement. You know, I can, you know, and looking, hindsight being 2020, I can see a lot of things have put me to the point where I'm at. You know, I want to do good for other people. I want to help people. My wife and I run a senior center here in Weston. You know, we're actively involved with the senior community to at the state legislature level. We're advocates for the seniors. So there's many things in my life we could point to that would say I'm a servant.
Excellent. Excellent. You got involved in Bible study. What led you to start studying the Bible? This is not something that everyone does. Although many are self-proclaimed Christians, the number, the percentage goes down dramatically when we take a look at who studies the Bible. We're in the lower percentiles of the Christian world who studies the Bible in America, North America. In other countries, we don't see the cavalier attitude towards the Bible that we see here in America. America is too informed, too entertained, too skating around on the ice, if you will, of Christianity, not really fully embracing the inerrant Word of God. What was the, you returned from a military career, 20 years, and you come back, you hadn't been really serving the Lord in a defined Christian role while you were in the service, but you came back. When did you start going to church?
Around 1985.
Okay. And
which about 5 years after I retired, I felt the inclination or the leaning to get back and start getting back into the Bible again.
Okay.
And I've discovered it to be, as it's been said many times, the greatest story ever told.
Yes. No question. What were some of the most profound experiences that you had in your return to church?
Well, going through this book has been, it's the old story, when you want to learn something, teach it. You know, that's when anybody that wants to learn a topic, okay, start teaching it, because you're going to learn it real fast. And this, the process of working on this book the last couple of years has so opened my eyes. I've been a student through YouTube of Chuck Missler, so I've listened to a lot of his materials and found what he has to say so intriguing. And that's actually, it was Dr. Missler his work was what got me interested in the Passion Week, the study of the Passion Week.
Very interesting. I'm a very deeply involved teacher, have been for a long time, in teaching the Jewish roots of Christianity. As a Jew, I see all the direct correlations between the New Testament writings and the experiences of Jewish life, as it would be since all the authors of the Bible were Jewish.
Right. One of the points I make in my book is we've got to remember that Jesus was a Jew. He followed Jewish customs, followed Jewish law. He was not a Christian.
Correct. There was no such thing as Christianity. Christianity came much later. And so,
that's right.
Mr. and Mrs. Christ did not have a little boy named Jesus. And there was no New Testament at the time of Jesus. And,
amen.
And yes, all the authors. Now, the church would like you to believe that Luke was a Gentile. But the legal case doesn't stand up. And I'll give you the legal case so you can investigate it. When Paul was taken before the Sanhedrin, he was charged with something. Do you remember what one of the charges was? The one charge that would have caused him to die.
Probably blasphemy.
No.
No?
The charge for death, that he was charged with for death, was bringing a Gentile into the temple.
Ah.
Now, when Peter went on trial, and Peter brought Luke into the temple, didn't he?
Okay.
Peter was not charged with bringing a Gentile into the temple. What does that mean about Luke?
And Luke wasn't guilty either.
Luke wasn't a Gentile.
Well, I'm sorry, yeah.
that Luke wasn't a Gentile.
Otherwise,
that would have been the top charge. Not preaching the gospel, the top charge would have been that you brought a Gentile into the temple. That's against the law.
Okay.
So when we look at this legal case, this legal argument for charges, if I commit the same crime, I'll be charged with the same crime.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the law works. If I didn't commit that crime, I'm not going to be charged with that crime. So we have one who was charged with that crime and another who was not in the same set of scenario under the same set of laws. So it was as cavalier as they might have thought the Pharisees might have been. They were certainly obedient to the law of the land and to what the position of a Gentile was, which was relegated to the court of the Gentiles as an outsider. We see the first time that in that vision that Peter was given about Cornelius, but that wasn't not the beginning of the reconciliation of Jew and Gentile. The reconciliation began in the Exodus with the mixed multitude. It was then increased when Ruth the Moabitess joined mm-hmm. herself to Israel with Boaz, that this became the lineage of David and the lineage of Messiah mm-hmm. and also the lineage of Mary. See, when you trace both their lineages back, that's one of the reasons why Mary's lineage is given in the Bible, is it's not significant unless you have to draw on rabbinical thought, which exists today, that you're not Jewish unless your mother's Jewish. So how do we establish that Mary was Jewish? We look at her lineage. We take her back to David. We take her back to this same lineage that both Joseph, for those that believe in the seed of Abraham, for those that are rabbinically inclined, both their lineage comes back to a common point.
Both Mary and Joseph were of the line.
That's correct. That is correct. So it's very important that we not set aside the Old Testament for the new, that we look at it as one book that does not start in the middle. It starts in the starts in the beginning. But this is a lesson that you learned. How did you learn that lesson?
Through Dr. Missler.
Okay. Have you verified, and I would say this about me as well, have you opened your Bible and looked it up and plotted it out for yourself?
No, I have not taken that time.
Okay. That would be very important for you to test all teachings against the Word of God, take everything that you hear and measure it against the Word of God and examine things for yourself. I always tell people that if it doesn't line up with the Word of God, it doesn't line up. And that's the same. I tell people to walk into my office with your Bible open. As far as opinions and commentary is concerned, we all have opinions. We can all embrace different commentaries. Dr. Missler, Arnold Fruchtenbaum, there's many great teachers out there. But ultimately, the end is always determined by what's contained in the pages of the Bible. So always a great admonition that I give to people that I teach. And I teach 4 days a week, as well as do this program 5 days a week. You entitled your book, The Great Christian Lie. I know that people will look at that and might have a visceral response to the word lie as a condemnation of, mm-hmm. of the church and the church teaching. What prompted you to pick that title?
Well, when you make going back to Webster, to make an untrue statement with intent to deceive, that's a lie. And there was a very, very clear intent by the early churches to do away with all Judaism and anything that has to do with Judaism. You know, the anti-Semitism was very, very strong at that time, and you know, they would have nothing to do with anything Jewish. Well, the Christ Passover happened on, I'm sorry, Christ's crucifixion happened just before the Passover, the daytime just before the Passover started, and the early church couldn't tolerate that relationship with the Passover.
You know who the author of that is, don't you?
Constantine.
Constantine's mother. Helena.
Okay. Okay.
It's Constantine's mother. There were three things in the letter. Okay? Three doctrines in the letter. Okay? Documented by Eusebius, 325 AD, the letter is dated. And the letter established the doctrine of the Trinity, changed the Sabbath to Sunday, and canceled all Passover observances, and only acknowledged Easter as the resurrection day. You were not to celebrate anymore the Passover. The letter is available to all. Eusebius was the writer, the scribe of the time who documented this, 325 AD. I actually have that teaching available on our teaching archives at www.ianbn.com, and it's very important that people understand this change. We're talking with Jack DeSelms, author of The Great Christian Lie, The Truth on Passion Week. Quite timely, as Passion Week is coming up. I've got five Passover Seders to do, and we'll be out and about in the community conducting Passover Seders and various events. You can check that out on the IgnitingANation.com webpage under events. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to dissect this Great Christian Lie, The Truth on Passion Week, and examine what the intent was and what the truth is. We'll be right back. This is Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker, Executive Director of Igniting a Nation Ministries, and your host for Revealing the Truth right here on the Igniting a Nation Broadcasting Network. I'm coming to you today with a very special offer from one of our very prominent guests, Dr. Carl Gallups. For your tax-deductible contribution of $30 or more, Pastor Carl Gallups will send you a signed copy of his new best-selling book, When the Lion Roars. In this book, you will discover what the Bible really says about the unprecedented demonic outpouring of the last days, the spirit of the days of Noah, the connection of technology and prophecy fulfillment, the spirit of Sodom and Gomorrah, apostasy in the last days church, why Turkey is central to last days prophecy, why Israel is the centerpiece of end time prophecy, the historical truth about Islam and ISIS, the Shemitah, the mystery of 666, and how Christians and the church should respond to these prophetic times. We are living in intense but exciting times. We're living in prophetically unprecedented times. Be on guard, prepare your heart and mind, make certain you have a biblical balanced understanding of our generation. Be ready with wisdom and perspective. We have been raised up for such a time as this. The lion of God's prophetic word is roaring. Do you hear its call? Send your check payable to Igniting a Nation, 2700 Corporate Drive, Suite 120, Birmingham, Alabama, 35242.
Hi, I'm Angela Waite, and I just finished my interview on Revealing the Truth with Rabbi Eric Walker. I hope that in some way you will be touched by my story and that you will receive the healing you so desperately desire. I would like to share my story with you and send you a personalized signed copy of my book, Bomb Pops, Blow Dryers, and Butterfly Kisses, for your tax-deductible gift of $25 or more to Igniting a Nation, Inc. I will personally send you my book along with a note of encouragement as you take this journey with me. You will not only be supporting the work of Igniting a Nation, but all the proceeds that I receive from book sales goes to support Ramsey's Rescue, which targets the physical and spiritual care of the little ones who have been abandoned. It is the goal of this ministry to provide food, clothing, education, medical, a safe and loving home, and hope. Please help support both ministries with your gift and make a difference in so many lives today. Send your check payable to Igniting a Nation, 2700 Corporate Drive, Suite 120, Birmingham, Alabama, 35242. May the Lord bless you for your generosity and support.
This is the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, Executive Director of Igniting a Nation and host of Revealing the Truth, right here on the Igniting a Nation Broadcasting Network, inviting you to join me every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday for our Prophecy in the News classes. Each week, I take the headlines from around the world that have a biblical connection and present them in a way that brings the news and the Bible to life. There are over 2,500 prophecies in the Bible, and there are so few classes available to see how they connect with world events. We cover everything from Islamic terrorism to the changing relationships between Russia, Turkey, Iran, Syria, and Israel. Prophecy is unfolding before our very eyes, and to many, it is complicated and hard to understand. In just 1 hour each week, you'll be given the tools and the biblical connection to world events. With so much going on and so few reliable sources of news, I encourage you to join me every Monday night at 7 o'clock p.m. at St. Mark United Methodist Church in Northport, every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. at Beechwood Baptist Church in Mount Olive, and every Thursday night at 7 p.m. at Mountain Chapel United Methodist Church in Vestavia. If you want to make sense out of what's happened in the world around you, this is the class for you. All are welcome. Times and location addresses can be found on our website at ianbn.com. I hope to see you there. Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker, Executive Director of Igniting a Nation Ministries, and your host for Revealing the Truth right here on the Igniting a Nation Broadcasting Network. I'm coming to you today with a very special offer from one of our very prominent guests, Dr. Carl Gallups. For your tax-deductible contribution of $30 or more, Pastor Carl. Shalom, and welcome back to this edition of Revealing the Truth, where we cover the headlines, the heart lines, and biblical truth. I'm your host, the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, and we're talking to Jack DeSelms, author of The Great Christian Lie, The Truth on Passion Week, brought to us by our good friends at WND and World Alive Books. We are very glad to have you with us, Jack DeSelms. Welcome back to the program.
It's my honor to be here, sir.
You know, Jack, you say in your book that the great Christian lie was that Jesus was crucified on a Wednesday, not a Friday.
Yes, sir.
A lie usually has a consequence associated with it, a kind of an outcome. What is the damage, in your estimation, in regards to Wednesday versus Friday?
Well, the damage done, you know, God throughout the Bible talks about how the truth is imperative. We are never to lie. And this has been, we can document that this is a lie. You know, a lie is intentionally telling something that's not true. So we know that that's the fact, that the moving of the day from Wednesday to Friday was done intentionally for anti-Semitic reasons.
Okay, this was a doctrine perpetuated by Rome for the purpose of breaking the back of Jewish worship, Jewish study, Jewish observance, God commanded us to look at a timeline which was lunar. It was not solar. It is much deeper, Jack, than most people really understand. However, since the statement of we are not under law, we're under grace, is there any grace in this? Certainly Helena, Constantine's mother, was looking to advance Rome, to advance her son, considered to be the emperor and the pope. This was the hat that you wore at that time, and to break the backs of those that rebelled. Remember, after the destruction of the Second Temple, there were two great revolts, two great uprisings that wound up. You've got the Bar Kokhba revolution, and you have what took place as the last holdout at Masada. If you have not been there, I would strongly suggest you go, because Masada is the absolute dividing line in humanity that says that a day will come when you can try on this decision yourself, when you have to be faced with the mark of the beast. Will you That's make right. the decision made at Masada, or will you make a decision which cost you your salvation? It's extraordinary what God is doing in the land of Israel and with these places. But
they not only did break the back of the revolution. They came through and plowed up the city, plowed up the temple area, and put a pagan temple on top of the Holy of Holies.
Well, I'm quite familiar, as is our audience. But if we look at pastors' seminary today, what obligation does the seminary have to take a tradition that Paul writes about in, I believe, Colossians, that says, do not criticize anyone for their Sabbath observance or their festival offering or their new moon observance? That, does this not fall into that category of tradition, celebration? Is it not all about Resurrection Day as being a day which is uniformly observed? And I'll give you my perspective on this, Jack, so that we can lay a foundation of understanding. Judaism existed 2,000 years before Jesus. Yep. During that 2,000 years, we adopted an identity, a form of worship, liturgy, feast days, feast day observance, and had a full-blown identity by the time that Jesus was brought to this earth.
Okay.
The traditions were well established. The psalms, the songs, the liturgy, whether it was in Hebrew or Aramaic, had already existed for, as we know it, based on scrolls about the discovery of the various synagogues throughout the region, the knowledge of Paul and Paul's writings, of his going to the synagogue, as was his custom, all these things well established, the pilgrimages that were made to Jerusalem for the three appointed feast days. And so we developed an identity and a tradition which still exists today, almost 4,000 years later, almost virtually unaltered in our Sabbath liturgy, in our feast day liturgy, all that exists today. And 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, from sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday, in every time zone, which are 24 across the world, every hour on the hour, Shabbat candles, Sabbath candles are being lit all around the world in a uniform observance. All around the world, the Shema, the various prayers of the Bible, Deuteronomy 6, verses 5 through 9, all those are recited and chanted uniformly around the world as a tradition. Now, Christianity comes along and is looking to establish some form of parallel, possibly counterfeit, but parallel, we'll call it for the time being, sense of tradition that could be observed uniformly. How do you unify an empire to follow along in a tradition which creates a certain compounding of one, if you will, that determines the strength of a community because everyone kind of worships the same way? So you establish something as a traditional day of observance to drive something that is as full and rich as the observance that you're looking to replace initially, but today to augment. Now today, here we are, we're 1700 years past the time of the writing of Constantine, of his mother Helena, the recorded doctrine, and today it's uniformly observed as Easter all throughout the world, Maundy Thursday, uniformly observed throughout the world, Good Friday, uniformly observed in all time zones across the world, and drives for one of only two traditions within all of Christianity that brings people to church two times a year, Christmas and Easter.
Right.
The time of the greatest number of salvations, the time of the greatest number of giving, the time of the greatest preaching of the gospel, the time of more people brought in, more outreach done on a singular day of the year than any other day in the entire Christian calendar. Let me ask you a question. If Jesus said, when two or more are gathered together in my name, there I will be in the midst of them, is he there at Easter in this Christian traditional observance?
I believe so, yes. Okay. When two or more are there, he's there.
Okay.
And, you know, we have some very, very devout people that are at Easter services. I prefer to call them Resurrection Sunday services.
Of course.
But they're there. You know, Easter is a takeoff of Estore, which is the Anglo-Saxon goddess of spring.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's also where we got the rabbits and the eggs and all the fertility that came out of there. That was also coming out of Babylon. So, you know,
are you familiar with the Passover tradition that was established after the destruction of the Second Temple? That an egg was introduced onto the Passover plate.
I've seen that. I do not understand it, but I've seen the egg. Okay. When my study of the Seder, I see the egg.
Yes, the egg is there. It's called Hagiga. The egg symbolizes God because an egg has no beginning and no end. It signifies life because God is the author of life. And as a rabbi, I wear black, as the rabbis do in Israel. As many rabbis, if you see us around, we wear black. Do you know why that tradition exists? It's a symbol of mourning for the Second Temple. And so we wear black as a sign of solidarity and mourning for the loss of the Second Temple. And we'll wear so until we can go back to white, which would be the symbol of the temple that was what Aaron and the priestly garment. So there's very rich in tradition that have come about as a remembrance. Because remember, God said in Exodus, when your children ask you, why do you do this? You tell them you do this in remembrance of me and my deliverance from bondage. When we take communion, we do this in remembrance mm-hmm. of me. Same words, exact same person, God speaking of something that existed, which was originated at the Passover Seder, at the third cup, the cup of redemption. The order is unique because the order of the Passover Seder starts with wine, then bread, then wine, then bread, then wine, then bread, then wine, and the final bread. But yet communion is reversed because it's right there as the in the middle of the Seder, and it's extracted from it in the reverse order.
Mm-hmm. Breaking the bread is the same as the breaking of the loaf and hiding half of it.
Well, loaf meaning if we're looking at unleavened bread, there wouldn't be a loaf. It would be a piece of matzah, unleavened bread.
Thank you.
So what I'm trying to do is put your book into an educational framework as opposed to a condemnational framework.
I firmly believe I've tried, I did the historical part the best I could, and then moved into an educational form.
Yeah, I think what I'm doing is looking at the title. If we want to encourage people to read your book, I don't want it to be off-putting, and this is why I'm giving this explanation to our audience, because we're in your book, we're talking about your book, and we want to position your book as something that is not condemning, it is to be revelatory from a standpoint of study, to look at the actual. What is the outcome that you would like derived from this book?
People would have a closer relationship and understanding of Jesus Christ.
Okay. Does this augment, add to, if I'm walking with the Lord and I'm in a Baptist church, I'm actually an ordained Baptist minister as well as a rabbi, do I need this in order radically sold out, I'm radically saved, I read my Bible every day, I study, I go to church, I go to Bible study, I'm immersed in the Word, I teach it to my children, I live that life, will this alter my walk with the Lord?
No, it may add a few shades of color to your understanding. The primary people that I would like to see reading this book are those who don't fall of that devoted and that devout of a relationship.
Would this drive them to go to a Messianic synagogue that observes the feast days on their actual day, as defined as the 10th of Nisan, the 14th of Nisan, the 15th of Nisan. We're looking at very important days from the book of Exodus in relationship to the selection of the Lamb, timed with Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem. When we look at Josephus, we find that on that day he reports 256,500 lambs. Even if he was five times wrong, it's still an extraordinary amount of lambs. Even if he estimated 2 million in the city and it was only 500,000 or 600,000, we're still talking about an extraordinary amount of sacrifice in a period of time that had to be timed specifically to twilight, which night fell early. So the priest had to hurry up and take the paschal lamb and time it such that Jesus' last three words, which actually, in my opinion, are the last three words of the Old Testament, "it is finished," are the exact words that the priest speaks when he cuts the throat of the paschal lamb. I think it gives you a deeper understanding of the timeline. For those that struggle with 3 days and three nights as being the sign of Jonah, it's hard to reconcile Friday to Sunday when you look at the biblical beginning of a day. When does a biblical day begin?
In the evening, sundown.
Sundown. So if I'm looking at this correctly, his entrance into Jerusalem was on the 10th. His exit was on the 11th. As he stood leaving Jerusalem, Matthew 23:37, on that same day, as he's leaving Jerusalem from that entrance on what would be considered to be by the church's Palm Sunday. And Sunday is actually the right day, as long as it's the 10th of Nisan.
Okay? Yeah.
And so when we look at the calendar, we do know that they did not get wrong, that the 10th of Nisan would have been on that year a Sunday, and he would have come in on the second half of Sunday, and he would have exited on the first part of Monday.
After
sundown. And that's when he declares in Matthew 23:37 that Jerusalem will not see him again until they cry out, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." It's a profound statement. How culpable are pastors and seminary graduates that do exactly what most people do, and that is teach what they've been taught?
How culpable? Mm-hmm. That's between them and God.
Okay. So
I'm not interested and I'm not eager to say that they're wrong. You know, I'm just saying this is my study, this is what I've come to understand. You choose to agree with it, that's wonderful. You choose not to agree with it, well, you and God are going to have a conversation about that.
What do you think it would do to the church if they return to a biblical calendar?
Well, there'd be an awful lot of mea culpas. You know, there'd be an awful lot of, if everybody suddenly realized, and you know, I just don't see that happening. You know, people are too entrenched in their positions. They have too much invested in their position. It's not my anticipation to see a great change in the leadership of the churches in this matter.
How many have you been to a number of Passover Seders?
I've been to no Seders.
Oh, you haven't been to a Seder?
No, not at all.
Okay. I would strongly encourage you to attend one being held there in your area by the Messianic congregation there in Kansas City.
That's good.
I would encourage you to sit at that table. You take communion, right?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Do you know why you take communion?
Well, other than when we gather together, this is what we're to do. Luke talks about it. 2 Corinthians talks about it. You know, Christ initiated it at the Last Supper.
So I'm going to kind of challenge you a little bit to think this through.
Okay.
So Acts chapter 15 has four requirements that came out of the Jerusalem Council. One of those requirements is to have nothing to do with the blood. This was now perpetuated and continued to be the law for the Gentiles. This was a continuation of the law in the Old Testament, that We shall not drink blood as the pagans do, or eat flesh as the pagans do. So Jesus declares in the book of John, if you do not eat my flesh or drink my blood, you have no part in me. 5,000 people get offended and walk away. He sits down as a Jewish observant, 2 Corinthians 5:17 kind of guy, who says, I didn't come to abolish the law of the prophets, I came to fulfill it. Yep. And yet he commands his 12 Jewish disciples to lift a cup, to lift the matzah, and declare that this is my body.
This is my blood.
This is my blood. What could he have possibly been telling them that was so profound and revelatory enough to cause them to understand what he was telling them? Because this was expressly forbidden under the law. They would be breaking the law. He would be breaking the law. 614 very specific commands of God that he claimed to have fulfilled. What was he saying to them that was so extraordinary that would cause not only he to command it, but 12 observant Jewish men to participate in it with him?
My answer, I'm afraid, would be superficial, as in this was a symbolism.
I'm sorry, we don't do symbolism in Judaism.
Okay.
The law is the law.
I understand. So that's why I apologize before
right.
I said that.
Right. The law is the law. But officer, I know that it said 55 miles an hour or 30 miles in a school zone, but I thought that was symbolic because the light was flashing, but I don't recognize that as a school because they don't teach this there.
Yes,
Okay, the law is the law.
I understand.
And the law had consequences. And the consequences were from mild to extraordinarily severe.
Yes.
His disciples would be put on trial. His followers would be stoned to death. What could he have been saying to them? Your answer is found in Exodus chapter 12, the very origin of your study, the very origin of your book.
Okay.
The answer lies within there. It is completely revealed to you. Exodus chapter 12 happened before a very significant event. That event happened on Mount Sinai. What was done on Mount Sinai?
Giving of the law.
Ah, so something had to occur before the giving of the law, which was so revelatory, that is so much a correlation between the story of the binding of Isaac, the Exodus, and the words of a Jewish prophet named John, who made an extraordinary statement in the Hebrew, not in the Greek. He was not a Greek speaker. He was the son of Zechariah, the priest. John would have proclaimed in Hebrew the words we know, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. There's two words in there, Jack, that are so extraordinary that I want you to look at them. Take away. Take away is only something that happened on the Day of Atonement. Today there is no place for the scapegoat and the sacrifice goat.
Nope.
So, if Jesus was the Lamb of God, and the Lamb was to be placed on a wooden stake and consumed until there was nothing left, and the blood was to be taken to seal the doorpost of the house,
mm-hmm.
Now what was Jesus telling you? He's telling you that I am not the Lamb of God, I am that Lamb. I am that Lamb that brings you redemption. I'm that Lamb you are to consume as you did in the Exodus. I am that Lamb whose blood is poured out for your redemption. So God will pass over and spare you from death. This is the message of salvation. And I'm sure that you've said this at some time in your life. I'm sealed by the blood of the Lamb. This is a reference to Exodus chapter 12. You've had this revelation, but the church has this revelation, but they don't grab a hold of this revelation. He says, I am not the Lamb of God. I am that Lamb.
That.
I am that Lamb in the Exodus. I'm that Lamb that provided for your redemption. And yes, you could have something to do with the blood. And yes, you were required to eat until there was nothing left. This is why communion is not a loaf. This is why communion is a small piece. You consume it until it's all gone. You are observing Exodus chapter 12 each and every time. You're sitting back at that Passover where you're standing up This is why when you go to church and you stand up and they bring you the elements and everyone, if they do it the way that I did it, everyone lifts their cup at the same time and gives thanks. Everybody lifts the bread and gives thanks at the same time. We all eat at the same time in haste. It's not something that's a prolonged activity. It's done quickly and everybody's served quickly. This is the Exodus. This is the Passover. This is the declaration of Jesus. And it's important that each and every person understands that this book is about this kind of revelation of Jesus as the Lamb of God, correlating the Passover to Exodus chapter 12. That this book, The Great Christian Lie, The Truth on Passion Week, takes you through the biblical timeline of the events from that Sunday you call Palm Sunday until Wednesday at 3 o'clock p.m., before the Sabbath began, before the Feast of Unleavened Bread, before this time. And we look at it as Preparation Day. We understand that there are more than one Sabbath. Sabbath is not always on Friday. There are a minimum of 64 Sabbaths in the Bible, a minimum of 64 in the Old Testament. So this is something you have to grab a hold of to understand this concept, which is of God. So Jack DeSelms, Great Christian Lie, The Truth on Passion Week from WND and World Alive Books. Thank you for being with us and sharing the truth about Passion Week with us.
Thank you.
We're going to take a break here and we'll be back with the next edition of Revealing the Truth.